Good morning, everyone. It feels almost like you know, a post-COVID Sunday morning where I have to get up here and say good morning, everyone, and stop the like chitter-chatter in the background. So that's a good thing. Thank you so much for being here on this Reformation Sunday. You'll notice that I'm dressed in red. The altar is dressed in red. The reason for that is that Reformation Sunday, the sort of liturgical celebration color for it is red. It's a color that gets us thinking about both martyrdom and how, you know, in order to have the church continue to go, there were people that had to stand up for what they believed. But also, it's kind of a celebratory color, and that's kind of the way that it is today. And in terms of Luther's seal, if you can kind of think about Luther's seal in your head in the full color version, one of the things that you see in there is that there's a red heart with a black cross in the middle of it. What Luther said about his own seal was that red heart was alive and well because it was red, and it was alive and well only because the cross in the center of it had sucked up all of the sin, and that's why it was black. And that's kind of what we're celebrating today as well. We're celebrating that we're alive and well, that our spiritual lives are alive and well because Christ has sucked up all of our sin and put that to death in the cross. And so we're going to get started this Reformation Sunday with the prelude. But before we get there, if you are joining us via YouTube, we want to let you know, seems like the stream on YouTube today, for whatever reason, is maybe a little bit wobbly. If that's the case for you, you can always go to Facebook and watch us there, or you can just wait a little bit later. We are recording this as well, and if the stream is wobbly, we'll upload a recorded version and put that up there. If you're here in person, you don't have to worry about any of that. I might get a little wobbly up here, but that's about all that'll happen. And so we're continuing a sermon series today. Our sermon series is called Outlaws, and in that we're kind of thinking about Luther as an outlaw, and that gets into the question for this morning. And the question is simply this: how was Martin Luther an outlaw? Think about that. Please rise. We begin on page 2 of your worship folders. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Take some time now to reflect upon those sins that you have committed and upon the forgiveness that Christ offers to you. Gracious Father of our risen Lord, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart, nor have we loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son, Jesus Christ, to die for us. For his sake, our sins are forgiven. As a called and ordained servant of this Jesus Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all of your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We continue with the entrance song, The Church's One Foundation. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, We continue with the Hymn of Glory. Be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Lord of all, as you have provided your Son to be a propitiation, his blood justifying us and giving us grace as a gift, grant that being so assured of our salvation and justification, we would proclaim your eternal gospel to all people. Amen. We continue with the readings. You may be seated.
The first reading comes from Revelation chapter 14, verses 6 through 7. Then I saw another angel flying directly overhead with an eternal gospel to proclaim to those who dwell on earth and to every nation and tribe and language and people. And he said with a loud voice, "Fear God and give him glory, because the hour of his judgment has come, and worship him who made heaven and earth, the sea and the springs of water." Here ends the first reading.
We continue by reading Psalm 46 together, the psalm that a mighty fortress is our God is based off of, your part printed in bold. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth gives way, though the mountains be moved into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble at its swelling,
there is God, whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High.
God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God will help her when morning dawns.
The nations rage,
the kingdoms totter. He utters his voice, the earth melts. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress.
Come
behold the works of the Lord, how he has brought desolations on the earth. He makes wars cease to the end of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the chariots with fire.
Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us.
The God of Jacob is our fortress.
The second reading comes from Romans chapter 3, verses 19 through 28. Now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be stopped and the whole world may be held accountable to God. For by works of the law, no human being will be justified in his sight, since through the law comes the knowledge of sin. But now the righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law, although the law and the prophets bear witness to it, the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. For there is no distinction, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a propitiation by his blood to be received by faith. This was to show God's righteousness, because in his divine forbearance he had passed over former sins. It was to show his righteousness at the present time, so that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. Then what becomes of our boasting? It is excluded. By what kind of law? By a law of works? No, but by the law of faith. For we hold that one is justified by faith apart from the works of the law. Here ends the second reading. Please stand for the gospel verse and the reading of the Holy Gospel.
According to St. Matthew, the 11th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. And Jesus said, "From the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven has suffered violence, and the violent take it by force. For all the prophets and the law prophesied until John, and if you are willing to accept it, he is the Elijah who is to come. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. But to what shall I compare this generation? It is like children sitting in the marketplaces and calling to their playmates. We played the flute for you, and you did not dance. We sang a dirge, and you did not mourn. For John came neither eating nor drinking, and they say, 'He has a demon.' The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say, 'Look at him, a glutton and a drunkard, a friend of tax collectors and sinners.' Yet wisdom is justified by her deeds." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, the Holy Three in One, who comes in order to assure us that it is okay for us to be outlaws in His kingdom. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, there's this website that came out in the 90s. It's called oldlutheran.com. You can go there and you can pick up all sorts of Lutheran junk. Martin Luther bobbleheads, bumper stickers, t-shirts, the whole nine. This is not a commercial for them. I'm just saying you can go there and get that stuff. And one of the things that they will sell you is something with their tagline on it that says, oldlutheran.com, the home of Lutheran pride, parentheses, just not too proud. Because it's kind of this Lutheran joke that we're sort of this self-deprecating people. We're these people that, you know, the moment that we start to feel like we have some pride in being Lutheran, that we kind of check that. And we check that against this epistle reading. We check that against that line that Paul writes, that we say that we are not going to boast in anything that we're doing, and we're going to boast in what Christ is doing. And that's something to keep in mind, I think, on a day like Reformation Sunday, a day that tends to be in Lutheran circles sort of Lutheran Pride Day. It's the one day that we can kind of be like, oh, you know, we actually maybe am kind of proud of being a Lutheran. You know, we have conflicted feelings about that, of course, but we sort of, you know, we enjoy singing "A Mighty Fortress Is Our God." We enjoy, you know, talking about all of these sort of inside Lutheran jokes sometimes. We enjoy, you know, that kind of a thing on this day, because on this day, Reformation Sunday, we think about the stuff that got us here, the stuff that got us to a church building that has Lutheran on the outside, and how that confuses so many of our friends, and how when we say, well, I'm a Lutheran, some people say, well, does that mean that you're a follower of Martin Luther King Jr.? And we go, no, he was a good guy, but knock off the last two names and we're good. So we get into this kind of like, well, what on earth does it mean to be a Lutheran? And a lot of times, you know, we start thinking about the story of Lutheranism and kind of how that comes together and what that means for us. And we you know, maybe we watch really boring Luther documentaries on PBS or wherever, and we try to remember some of that stuff and keep it in our heads. Well, one of the things that you maybe picked up in one of those Luther documentaries was that Luther himself was actually an outlaw for a little bit. You see, what Luther did in standing up to the Roman Catholic Church of his time was a big, big no-no. A big, big no-no that even could have gotten him killed. And so because of that, in April 1521, Luther gets kidnapped by his own people. So he's got this friend who is Frederick, the Elector of Saxony. He's a friend in high places with his own sort of, you know, set of bodyguards, and he sends his set of bodyguards after Luther in order to kidnap him and make it look like the Roman Catholic Church has kidnapped him so that nobody else will. So they take him, and then they take him to this place called Wartburg. And they take him to this place called Wartburg, where he chills out for about a year. And he exists as an outlaw. And he literally is an outlaw at this point. He's got a price on his head. He's done something so bad in the eyes of some people that he deserves to die. And to Luther, this doesn't seem right, and to other people, this doesn't seem right, but he takes that period of time, and he uses it, and during that period of time, he gets locked up in a room. He literally is sort of on house arrest. It's not like he gets taken off to Wartburg and everything is all hunky-dory. He basically has to stay in his room the entire time, at least at first, because people are afraid that they're going to find out that they're hiding Luther, and that's going to turn out bad for the people with Wartburg. And so he's in this hunting lodge, basically, is what Wartburg is. It's a hunting castle, so it's sort of like, you know, Elector Frederick takes him and puts him off in the place where he would go for maybe a week or two at a time while he's hunting, but otherwise there's nothing there. But there's this special sort of room, and it's a special sort of room in which they would use to specifically imprison knights, not N-I-G-H-T, but K-N-I-G-H-T, they got kind of special privileges, and so because of that, they got kind of the, you know, the white collar prison. So it was a little bit nicer, but it was still prison.
And so he was there for a while, and he was, you know, growing out his hair and growing out his beard, and he started to go under the name of Junker George, which is just a silly name. But it means Knight George. So he was going by that, and he was there, and he was just, pushing back from all of the excitement of what had happened in his life up until that point. And it had been an exciting life for Luther up until that point. He had gone to law school. He was starting to go to law school. And then after that, that got changed by a big thunderstorm. During that, he almost got fried by some lightning. And he cried out to God and he said, "I'll become a monk." And a lot of Luther's biographers think that he probably already had that in the back of his mind, and maybe this was just a moment where he was like, hey, here's a good reason for me to be a monk. And so he goes back to his dad, and he tells his dad that, and his dad, of course, is disappointed, but he lets him go to the monastery, and while he's a monk, he is both a great monk and a terrible monk. He's a great monk to all of the sort of outward appearances of what it means to be a monk. He's really hardworking. He does a lot of penance. He reads the Bible a lot, but to the other monks, they don't like him because of all of those things, because he reads the Bible a lot, because he does a lot of penance, and he makes them look bad. And so he's there, he's a monk for a while, but then he discovers this book of Romans, this book that we just read from, and he goes, wait a second, I think that there's something here that isn't being communicated out to God's people from the church, and that's a problem. And so he's an academic at this point. He wants to start to discuss this and debate this. He wants to say, hey, why aren't we talking about this stuff? This is important stuff. Paul wrote this stuff down so that we could tell people that it was not up to them, but rather that Jesus saved them. Why are we not talking about that? And so he goes, and that's the famous point at which he knocks that 95 theses on the door. And what he's trying to do there is he's trying to basically sort of bait people into arguing with him. And what it ends up doing is it gets spread all throughout Germany. And because of that, he starts getting a lot of sort of negative attention from the people in Rome. And then they start taking him to court. They start asking him to do things like recant. They start asking him to do things where they say, you need to stop talking. And Luther is not real good at stopping talking at this point, and he keeps on talking, and that's eventually what ends him up in Wartburg as an outlaw under an assumed name, chilling out under house arrest in a white-collar prison. And he takes a year there. Roughly about a year. We know that he goes in April of 21. We know that he gets out sometime in 22. And we look at what he does during that time, and he even does a lot while he's in there. He starts this famous book of his called The Bondage of the Will. He works quite a bit on his German translation of the New Testament. He gets a lot done while he's there as an outlaw. But he's still an outlaw. And being an outlaw is kind of a lonely thing. For Luther, it meant that he couldn't be around a lot of the people that he really loved and wanted to be around. It meant he couldn't be around his sort of chief disciple, a kid named Philip Melanchthon. It meant he couldn't be around the churches of his age. It means that he couldn't have been around many of the people whom he considered his parishioners, the people that were in his church. He couldn't be around those people either. And it was lonely. And I wonder how much we feel like we're outlaws in that sense this year. I mean, it hasn't even been a year yet. won't be a year until March, really, that we've been dealing with this, even though in a lot of ways it feels like we've been dealing with this coronavirus and this isolation and this outlaw existence for so long. And maybe we're asking ourselves, you know, okay, well, if I'm a Lutheran, what does it mean for me to be an outlaw? Does that mean that I have to be, you know, start translating the New Testament? What am I doing with this time? But I think in a lot of ways, it's not good for us to just say, what am I doing with this time period that I have while I'm being outlawed? But it's worthwhile us thinking about, what does it feel like to be an outlaw? And sometimes that feels pretty stinking lonely. It feels like we're not connected with the people that we want to be connected with. Maybe, you know, maybe we're connected with them through the internet. Maybe we're connected with them through a phone call. But there's so much that still feels disconnected right now. So much so that this Reformation Day doesn't feel exactly like Reformation Day. Doesn't feel like that if you're in the sanctuary with us today, because Reformation Day is usually a day where we would fill up the pews. And, well, we're filling up the pews today because, well, we only set out a certain amount of them. And if you're joining us online, it doesn't feel the same because, well, you're sitting there in your red pajamas and, you know, you're drinking a Lutheran beverage. Well, maybe not yet, but, you know, it's kind of like, okay, is this Reformation Day? And it, as we go through this, we're continually asking ourselves, okay, what does it mean for us to be in this situation of being outlaws around these kind of bigger holidays? And even these minor holidays, like, if Reformation Day is a minor holiday for you, if you're not a Lutheran pastor, or you're not a Lutheran super fan. And yet, there's hope in Luther's story. Luther has to start doing things differently. He has to, we know he grows out his beard. We know that the tonsure, that you know, that sort of fake bald spot that you see Luther with, that sign of being a monk, he lets that grow out as well. He starts doing stuff a little bit differently. He starts living his days a little bit differently. But as a result of what he has to go through, he comes out of that with a renewed sense of how valuable the Word of God is. He comes out of that experience with a new sense of how he's going to change what he was doing from simply being sort of an irritant to the church at its time to being something that was starting a movement. He comes out of Wartburg, and he starts to shift things, and he starts to say, all right, it looks like being an irritant isn't going to work. The Roman Catholic Church is going to excommunicate me. They're just going to push me off. They're going to try to kill me. That's not going to work. I'm not going to be able to just reform the church in that way. So what I have to do is I have to figure out how to make this a movement. I have to figure out how this becomes something where we can work outside of the church. Because for Luther, that's what he's doing. I think we don't really understand that in a lot of ways. For Luther, what the church is the Roman Catholic Church. There is no other church. It's not like where we're living, where there's 15 gazillion other denominations out there. Luther is looking at this and he's saying, this gospel is so important that it needs to be spread outside of the church. It needs to be spread in some way that is working outside of the normal, humdrum, everyday existence of what it means to be church. And I think that's maybe something that God is trying to get us to take notice of today. as we exist in our outlaw form in the midst of this pandemic. Maybe God is saying, you have relied on the machinery of the church too much. And you have taken the machinery of the church and you have lifted it up as an idol above me. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to take that away from you so that you can see that there is a way that my gospel will go out from this place without the machinery of a church, or at least a church building, or church service. And sure, the gospel can continue in those things, but I think God is asking us to start thinking about how we exist as his outlaw church. How we work through things that are not a pastor and a video camera. How we work through things that are not on a Sunday morning. How we engage with what that angel in Revelation was talking about. That we have an eternal gospel that is to go out to every tribe and language and people and nation and everybody. And if we are going to take what that angel has seriously, what that command, that gospel needs to go out, we need to do that in our own lives as well as in our church lives. We need to become a movement again. A movement that understands the importance of that gospel. A movement that understands that that gospel is that we are saved not because of our works, but because of what Jesus Christ has done for us. And that that is something that he wants to go viral. Seems strange using that word now, given our context. That's what God wants us to do. He wants us to cough the gospel onto people. He wants us to be unmasked about the gospel. He wants us to be people that go out into this world and infect it with his love and his grace and his forgiveness. That's what it means to be a Lutheran in so many ways. To believe in that gospel and the power of that gospel so firmly that we're even willing to let it spill as outlaws outside of the church. So may you this week, may you celebrate your Lutheran identity if you have that. May you celebrate even more so, though, the thing that gives us that identity. The gospel of Jesus Christ, crucified, died, buried, and raised again. And may that cause you to move and be an outlaw yourself. Amen. Please rise as we continue with the hymn of the day.
Thank you.
continue by confessing our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed found on page 10 of your worship folder. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We continue by gathering gifts and prayer. We ask that if you have a prayer request for us today, that you would put that in the chat function of wherever you're watching this. We'll make sure that we pick that up. If you're here with us in the sanctuary today and you have a prayer request, just let me know about that after worship. Be happy to pray about that with you either right at that time or continuing on. You have a gift to bring to God's altar, if you're here in the sanctuary with us today, there is a basket over there by the extra hand sanitizer and extra mask. We ask that you would use that as we're not going to be passing around a basket. If you are joining us online, we ask that you would go to universitylutheranchurch.org. And if you scroll down a little bit there, you can find a button that says Give Now. We ask that you would use that if you're planning on engaging in this Christian discipline of giving tithes and offerings. With that, we continue with our offertory prayer. Let us pray. Lord God, you do not call your church to bring gifts of extravagance to your altar in order to worship you. While gold, silk, and other fineries are befitting your praise, you ask only that we bring simple gifts, reflecting our vocations and incomes, that you may use those things by the work of your church to accomplish your will. Therefore, we bring you these things that your will may be done through our gifts. Amen. We continue with the offertory. Church. Heavenly Father, we ask that you would hear us now as we pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We thank you, O Lord, for those whom you have called to be fellow disciples with us and members of University Lutheran. Today we thank you especially for Ian Guthrie, Mary Hafner, and Wilma Harris. Grant them your grace as they continue to follow you. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord of heaven and earth, as you have sent us an eternal gospel, grant that we would proclaim it to every nation and tribe and language and people, that all people may give you glory. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O refuge and strength, as you have promised to be with us through all calamities and dire situations, enable us to be still in knowing that you are God. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Righteous Lord, as you have provided your righteousness to us, manifested outside of the works of the law and in the person of Jesus Christ, grant that we would cease our boasting in anything but you. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
King of heaven, as we look to you, give us the ability to seek your kingdom without seeking our own glory. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord God, we thank you for years of life for so many in our community, and we thank you especially for years of life for Larry Dean, for Scarlett Holcomb, for Becca and Eva Paul, and for Ryan Truchelet this week. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We continue to pray for our world, especially in the midst of this virus outbreak. We ask that you would bring a swift end to the pain and suffering caused by the virus, that you would comfort those who mourn and those concerned for their loved ones, and we ask that you would empower those whose vocations serve the endangered and the infected. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all those for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
We invite you to share the peace with one another. If you're online with us, we ask that you would just use that chat function. If you're here in the building with us, we ask that you would share the peace. Just don't touch other people. You can move around, just don't touch. So share the peace with one another. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to
give him thanks and praise. It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, O Lord, Holy Father, almighty and everlasting God. For you have proclaimed an eternal gospel to all who dwell on earth, to every nation and tribe and language and people. For this gospel centered in Jesus Christ, we give you glory and we worship you, who made heaven and earth. Therefore, with angels and archangels and all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and singing. Jesus Christ, on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also, after supper, he took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of all of your sins. This do as often as you drink of it, in remembrance of me." Blessed are you, Lord of heaven and earth, for you have justified us by your grace as a gift, through our redemption received by faith in Jesus Christ, to whom all the scripture points, and in whom we receive the gift of your Holy Spirit. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.
If you are joining us online at this moment, we ask that this moment would be a time of prayer for you, a time of prayer for this virus to end, and we can get back to sharing the Lord's Supper in the way that we once did. Also, a time to pray in thanksgiving for the unity that the church has outside of meeting together, that unity that is the invisible church. If you are here with us in person, we ask that what you would do is that you would come forward and that you would take the elements back to your seat, and that you would then consume the elements back at your seat, and then you would wait until at some point during the communion hymn in order to return those elements back to this basket with that's sitting on the table here in order to return those elements so that you do not have to deal with them anymore. We look forward to celebrating this together once again, and we also include you all in our celebration who are joining us online. Take and eat, take and drink. This is the true body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Please rise. We continue with a prayer for spiritual communion of those joining remotely. Lord Jesus, we believe that you are present in this holy sacrament. We love you above all things and desire to receive you into our souls. Since many cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, we ask that you would unite them with yourself and with us by the power of your Holy Spirit, until that day comes when we are gathered together at your throne in the resurrection. Amen. Now may this, the eating and drinking of Christ's true body and blood, keep and preserve you in the one true faith, now until forevermore. Amen. We continue with the canticle.
Let us pray. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift, and we implore you that of your mercy you would strengthen us through the same in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
Amen. Just a few quick announcements for you, so please have a seat. First announcement is, obviously, we're having in-person services. You all who are joining online are welcome to join us. We do ask that, especially if you have more than one person in your party that is planning on being with us, that you would register ahead of time. We usually have a number of single spots out for people that just show up the day of. But if you have a larger party than that, it is helpful for us to be able to maintain social distancing and be able to make sure that we've got enough chairs out for people and things like that. So today is one of the big celebration days of the church, next Sunday is All Saints Sunday. It's actually going to fall on All Saints Day, which is semi-rare. One of the things about All Saints is that one of the things that we do is we remember the lives of people that have gone before us with thanksgiving. Normally we do that in our prayer, and we give you an opportunity to speak their names out loud or quietly to yourself. That's not going to be the same this time around. So we ask that if you would like to, we'll make that opportunity available if you're here in the sanctuary, or you can write those people's names in the chat function. But if you would also like to send us an email so that we make sure that those people's names are said, we will certainly take that email and make sure that their names are said during that prayer. We also have a bunch of things happening this week. On Tuesday, we have another prayer gathering, and so that is going to be Tuesday evening, and so join us for that. That's a student event, and it'll be held here at University Lutheran over in the library. We also are going to be having this Friday, we're going to be having a Halloween get-together, and so keep that in mind. That's also a student event if you're planning on joining that. That said, I think that's all of the announcements that I have right now. Go in peace. Serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Amen.
That must be